This is a messy story about how multiple people independently discovered the same comet, and how the way that credit was ultimately assigned changed astronomy forever. So let's set the scene. It was the early 1840s, and American astronomy looked pretty different than it does today. Europe was way ahead in the field, with advanced observatories and publicly funded research. In contrast, America lagged behind, with only a few scattered telescopes that were either privately owned or funded through community efforts. There was a small community of American astronomers who wanted to be taken seriously by their European colleagues, but US Congress had repeatedly refused requests to build some permanent observatories. One thing that did manage to inspire funding was the observation of comets. Comets are these small bodies that orbit the sun, and they're made up of ice, dust, and rock. When a comet gets close to the sun, its ice turns straight into gas, forming a visible atmosphere called a coma, and often forming a tail that extends away from the sun. These features make comets one of the most spectacular objects in the night sky. Yale had invested in a telescope to observe the return of Halley's Comet in 1835, but it was a few years later, in 1843, that another comet caused a stir. The best observations of it were taken by Philadelphia Central High School, who had 3 years earlier spent educational funds to set up an observatory equipped with German instruments, including a 13-centimeter refractor telescope. For a while, this high school had the best observatory in America. In 1847, Harvard University, feeling the pressure of having been beaten by a high school, managed to crowdsource $25,000 from the citizens of the Boston area to get their own German-made telescope. Amid this backdrop, Nantucket Island emerged as an unlikely hub of astronomical activity. This was a place that did care about astronomy. It was a place known predominantly for its whaling industry, and that fostered an environment where astronomy was practical. The whalers were reliant on celestial navigation, and so astronomical tools and observations became part of their daily lives. On one clear night in 1847, amidst a house party being held at her home, a 29-year-old woman named Maria Mitchell excused herself from the social gathering to go upstairs and observe the stars. Her father had installed a telescope in the home because he was a keen amateur astronomer and was also involved in doing astronomical observations for the town's navigational tools. It was not unusual for Maria, who shared her father's passion for astronomy, to spend her nights at the telescope. At the age of 18, she had been recruited to be the librarian at the Nantucket Library, where in her spare time she had been able to teach herself celestial mechanics by reading classic works such as those from Laplace and Gauss. By her early 20s, she had a good grasp on physics and had mastered observing through a telescope. Maria regularly swept the sky using her father's 7-centimeter refractor, observing things like the moon, sunspots, meteors, stars, and looking for nebulae and double stars to add to a catalogue. This was hard work, physically tough on the body, and required a lot of skill and patience. That night, October 1st, 1847, through her telescope, Maria spotted an unknown comet streaking across the sky. Excited by her discovery, she quickly fetched her father from downstairs and asked him to confirm her observations. I can imagine that this potential thrill of discovering a comet is one of the things that kept her coming back night after night to her telescope. They recorded the time as 10:30 p.m., with the comet located 5 degrees above the star Polaris. The significance of Maria's discovery was monumental, although she was initially unaware of its full implications. The King of Denmark actually offered a gold medal to anyone who discovered a new comet. Unbeknownst to Maria, her find qualified her for this prestigious award, but there were some strict rules that she would need to follow. Here are those rules. That if the discoverer is from Europe, they must make their discovery known to Mr. Schumacher, and if they live elsewhere, they have to make it known to a Mr. Airy. This communication must be made by the first post after the discovery. If there is no regular mail at the place of discovery, the first opportunity of any other kind must be made use of without waiting for other observations. Exact compliance with this condition is indispensable. If this condition is not complied with and only one person discovers the comet, then no medal will be given for the discovery. Otherwise, the medal will be assigned to the discoverer who earliest complies with the condition. There's a reason that the communication laws are this way, and it's actually that Mr. Schumacher and the King of Denmark together started a scientific journal called AN, and one of the points of this award for the comets is to increase the profile of that journal. They want that journal to become a clearinghouse where everyone sends their discoveries to, and this is one way to ensure that it gets that kind of status. Later it says that the expectation of obtaining a second observation will never be received as a satisfactory reason for postponing the communication of the first. The medal will be assigned 12 months after the discovery of the comet, and no claim will be admitted after that period. The rules are pretty clear, and it's also clear that Maria did not follow them. In fact, it doesn't seem like she is even aware of the competition at all. Maria, prioritizing scientific rigor over accolades, decided to wait and observe the comet again the following night before making any public announcements. She wasn't 100% sure that it was a comet. It was faint and it could have been a nebula not observed before. A second observation would be able to provide evidence that it was moving. Maria and her father observed the comet again on October 2nd, and it had indeed moved. This delay in reporting might have proved costly. The next night, on October 3rd, Francesco di Vico, an astronomer at the Vatican, also observed the same comet and immediately sent notice, placing him first in line to win the King's Medal. The Mitchells did not send news of their comet to the AN Journal, but Maria's father did send a letter to his friend William Bond. William Bond had a background as a clockmaker and amateur astronomer and was recently appointed director of the Harvard College Observatory. He had helped the Mitchell family to set up the Nantucket Observatory. William Bond had a son, George, who was 7 years younger than Maria, but also a keen astronomer. It seemed that Maria Mitchell and George Bond were the only two Americans involved in searching for comets in the early 1840s. Mr. Mitchell wrote to William Bond on October 3rd to ask if the comet was one of George's. It was received on October 7th. Here's the letter here. It says, "My dear friend, I write now merely to say that Maria discovered a telescopic comet at 10:30 on the evening of the 1st of October. Last evening it had advanced westwardly. Maria has obtained its right ascension and declination, and will not suffer me to announce it. Pray tell me whether it is one of George's, if not whether it has been seen by anybody." In a reply from the Bonds, it was clear that they hadn't observed it. It was William Bond who then notified a journal, the MNRAS, which published a note in November 1847 called Miss Mitchell's Comet, mentioning observations by Maria and a few other people. These were independent discoveries of the same comet, but this note establishes that Miss Mitchell had the priority of discovery. But this journal is not linked to that valuable golden medal. What happens next is due to the intervention of one new character to the story, Edward Everett. Everett was the president of Harvard and had previously served as the US ambassador to the UK. He had sent a letter to Schumacher, that was the convener of the Danish medals and the editor of the AN Journal. This letter was about an unrelated matter. In fact, it was to show off Harvard's new telescope that they'd received in 1847. And this letter also mentioned that George Bond had found a comet before any information about it had reached the US from Europe. It was in Shoemaker's reply to this letter that Everett must have learned of the existence of the Danish medals. So upon hearing about Miss Mitchell's comet, Everett made it his mission to see that Maria was awarded one. He was likely motivated by wanting to see fairness brought to Maria, but in his position, he would also have loved to see American astronomy gain recognition in Europe. So far, all the medal-winning comets had been discovered in Europe, except for one by James Dunlop, discovered in New South Wales, Australia. If Everett helped Maria, it would also help to raise the profile of Harvard. So he replies to Schumacher's letter about the medals and says that the regulations of the prize have not been understood in this country. He thinks that George Bond had previously lost a medal by not following the rules, and he feared the same was happening to Miss Mitchell. And there's other people who seem to have missed out on medals in the past. A Dr. Bremiker lost the medal because he allowed a single post day to pass before he announced his discovery. That in itself could probably be seen as a nail in the coffin for Mariah ever getting a medal herself. But Everett says that because they actually did send a letter to William Bond by the next available mail that could have left the island, it's as possible, barely possible, that this may be considered as a substantial compliance with the regulation. That even though they didn't notify the right person, they notified someone as soon as they could. Because of bad weather, no mail had actually left Nantucket Island before that letter that went to Mr. Bond. He says at any rate, it is worth trying. And so he gets from Mr. Bond the original letter from Mr. Mitchell and packages it up to send it to the medal conveners as a kind of evidence. Writing to Schumacher, he really tries to sell the case. He says, Nantucket, as you are probably aware, is a small secluded island lying off the extreme point of the coast of Massachusetts. Mr. Mitchell is a member of the Executive Council of Massachusetts and a most respectable person. As the claimant is a young lady of great diffidence, the place a retired island, remote from all the high roads of communication, and as the conditions have not been well understood in this country, and especially as there was a substantial compliance with them, I hope His Majesty may think Miss Mariah Mitchell entitled to the medal. This letter shows an interesting challenge of trying to establish priority in discovery at a time where there are no photographs or digital timestamps to prove that you found something first. Calling Mr. Mitchell a most respectable person is important. He has to be seen as an esteemed gentleman because you have to be able to trust the entries he has made in his journal and the dates on the letters that he has written. Diary entries are actually pulling a lot of weight here, and so you have to be able to have some level of trust that the date and time that someone wrote down is the truth. After a bit of back and forth, a devastating reply comes back to Everett. Mr. Schumacher and Mr. Airy, the conveners of the medal, have conferred, and it says, we agree without the smallest hesitation that we cannot award the medal. We have in all cases acted strictly in conformity with the published rules, and it is absolutely necessary that we do not depart from them. But then they do suggest the only way that Miss Mitchell's claim may move forward is if she makes an application to the King of Denmark. Only the King can, if he pleases, make exceptions to the usual rules. So it's time to go straight to the King. There's a bit of pleading to be done with the gatekeepers before they get there. We see Everett again saying things like that if Mr. Mitchell had only addressed his letter to the Danish minister instead of to Mr. Bond, then his daughter would have been entitled to the medal under the strict terms of the regulations, and that it is only due to a misunderstanding of the regulations that this didn't happen. I feel like he's bending it a little bit, given that the Mitchells didn't seem to know about the competition at all, but he insists that the spirit of the rules were followed. He mentions how the comet is constantly called Miss Mitchell's comet in the other journal, and importantly, he mentions that he's met Francesco De Vico, the guy who is set to receive the medal for this comet. Apparently, De Vico came to Cambridge and spoke of Miss Mitchell's priority as an undoubted fact. Maybe Francesco was willing to let this one go, because he actually won a total of 6 of the Danish medals for himself, including 4 for comets that he found in 1846, the year before Miss Mitchell's comet was discovered. Then on the 6th of October, 1848, Mr. Knuth, who seems to be kind of an ambassador of the United States, has managed to get the question all the way to the King. And he says, I have much pleasure in being now enabled to inform you, sir, that His Majesty has not hesitated to grant your request by awarding to Miss Mitchell the medal which she desires. As soon as this medal is struck, I will have it forwarded to you. The medal was awarded to Mariah in 1848, the same year that the King of Denmark died, and not long after this, the medal was discontinued. So all this had happened just in time to make a splash. Mariah became a sort of celebrity after winning the medal, with hundreds of articles published about her. Mariah Mitchell's legacy extends far beyond her initial discovery, and she had a fruitful career in astronomy, becoming known as America's first female astronomer. Not long after winning the medal, she accepted a job with the US Nautical Almanac, tracking the positions and movements of the planet Venus to assist sailors in navigation. She became a professor at Vassar College despite not having a college education of her own, and by the age of 32, she became the first woman elected to the American Academy of Arts and Sciences. She fought for reform to help other women access higher education, and through this, she paved the way for future generations, but also helped to advance astronomy in America and around the world. One of the reasons I feel inspired by Mariah is that she made observing through her telescope a daily habit. It was this dedication to pushing herself every day that ultimately gave her great success. Learning a little every day is one of the most important things you can do, both for your personal and professional growth. This video's sponsor is Brilliant, which helps you build real knowledge in minutes a day with fun lessons you can do whenever you have time. Learning with Brilliant is a way to form a powerful daily habit of your own, and it's a nice antidote to mindless scrolling. One of their courses is called Scientific Thinking, which takes you on an interactive tour of our physical world. You'll engage with key scientific principles and theories, from simple machines like gears and pulleys to Einstein's special theory of relativity. Through these lessons, you can build your natural intuition while gaining deep knowledge of the scientific principles. It's perfect for learners of every level, and no heavy math is required. To build your own powerful daily habit, you can try everything Brilliant has to offer for free for a full 30 days. Visit brilliant.org/tibbies or click on the link in the description. You'll also get 20% off an annual premium subscription. Thanks, Brilliant, and thanks to my Patreon supporters for making this video possible. A special shout out to today's Patreon cats of the day, Dora and Diego.